can't be reached by ordinary methods of attack. Take, for example, the one being discussed at a staff meeting.
Intelligence has just brought in a report on Aarborg. 16 ships, loaded with munitions and other military supplies, have just anchored there. It is essential to the success of our northern operations that these supplies be destroyed. We do not wish to destroy the harbor facilities, since the docks will be very valuable when we capture the city. Let us look at the chart. The photo shows us the ships anchored and awaiting dockage space. Being a chief supply port for the northern front, it has been given ample air protection with both anti-aircraft and fighters. The channel is narrow, protected by shore batteries, and the approaches are thoroughly mined, making submarine attack impossible. This, then, is the complete picture. It rules out any economic method of attack except that carried out beneath the surface of the water. This job calls for an attack by individuals, well-trained, well-armed, and well-equipped.
Well-trained, well-armed, and well-equipped. These are the keynotes of operations of all kinds. Underwater operations, however, demand more specialized training and equipment. Only recently have the techniques and tactics of this unique form of attack been developed. Let's see how this special equipment was used in the raid on Aarborg. These are trained men, equipped with enough explosive to do their task, equipped so that they can work quickly, quietly, destructively. The operation has been carefully planned so that the swimmers can utilize the incoming and outgoing tides. Powered with a silent electric motor, low in the water, the surfboard can come within 500 feet of its target without detection. A buoy or channel marker is selected as the rendezvous. From there, the operator can swim underwater to his target, fix the charges, and return in well under an hour. Let's go back to the training station so we can see how these men learn how to do this work. These men were carefully selected before training started. Men of fine physique, thoroughly at home in the water. Marathon swimmers, lifeguards, fishermen, to whom the sea is but a continuation of the land, holding no fears. Each man is first introduced to the diving unit, the key to underwater operations. The unit is simple, and the student learns how it works. From the cylinder, oxygen slowly flows into a rubber bag. This supply flows back into the facepiece and is breathed by the swimmer. The exhaled air passes back through the canister of lime, which absorbs the carbon dioxide, sending the oxygen through the tube for reuse. If the normal flow is not enough, the operator can give himself an additional supply by turning the knob. A gauge tells him how much oxygen is left in the cylinder. The system is completely self-contained, and there are no escaping bubbles to reveal his position. He learns how to maintain the unit. Each cylinder will allow him to remain underwater for about 90 minutes. The thin rubber suit serves a dual purpose. In cold water, it retains the natural heat of the body, and in tropical waters, it acts as a protection against fish, sharp rocks, etc. These special live rubber fins can double his underwater speed. He learns the special stroke that is most effective with this equipment. For surface movements prior to reaching the objective, this surfboard has been developed. This size board will carry two men with their entire gear. Much lower in silhouette than a rubber boat, it can be used in many types of amphibious work as well. It's powered with a small battery-driven motor. To guide the men, both on the surface of the water and beneath it, compass and depth gauge, fitted in watertight cases and with luminous dials, are used. With this equipment, it is a simple matter to turn a good swimmer into an expert underwater operator, able to swim a mile and work for more than an hour underwater. In addition to his compass, the swimmer can rise just far enough to get his eyes above the surface and take his bearings. In the average harbor waters, he cannot be noticed. A limpet, held magnetically to the hull, is placed on each side of the ship, opposite the engine room, and just a few feet beneath the surface. To add to the confusion, a small charge is set to cut the anchor chain a few minutes before the limpets explode. Their job done, they escape safely unnoticed back to the submarine. The target ship has been picked according to its position and the harbor currents, so that its drifting will create as much confusion as possible. The enemy now knows that something is drastically wrong, but the reason for the explosion is still, and probably will continue to be, a mystery. Sabotage? No unauthorized personnel were aboard. Air or sea attack? No visible signs of the attackers. No evidence remains on which to plan future defense, and any future precautions can be overcome by the ingenuity of our underwater operators. This is one type of problem that can be solved by underwater operations, where other methods would probably fail. There are other such problems. A raiding party needs accurate beach reconnaissance. It invariably sends a scouting party to land first and secure information. Two of the scouting party are expert underwater swimmers, equipped with diving units. They explore the beach for depth, natural obstacles such as reefs, or for things like barbed wire or mines. A single operator can create great confusion, damage, or delay merely by cutting buoys loose and allowing them to drift. He can also prepare the way for surface or submarine attack by eliminating mines, booms, or nets. An operator dropped with equipment far behind the enemy lines can swim downstream, starting from an unguarded section of the shore. Upon reaching his objective, such as a vital railroad bridge, he places explosive. By the time the explosive goes off, giving the alarm, the operator, a native of the country in which he works, can obtain refuge. This approach, beneath the surface, is the only one to many well-guarded objectives. In no other way can such precision demolition be achieved. Here is a new weapon, silent and deadly, precise and destructive. One that has all the elements of surprise and mystery. It is a factor that can play a decisive and vital role in any campaign where water approaches exist.